Hi, this is Scott Erickson with Digital Technology Group. DTG is a computer graphics systems reseller. I'm selling capture to finish solutions, including digital cameras, scanners, printers, heat presses, trimming and cutting devices, as well as media and supplies. Today, we are going to discuss the new Epson F570 die sublimation printer. It's a 24-inch die sub printer with kind of mini bulk inks, and we're going to basically show you how it's received, or talk about how it's received, show you how to unbox, set it up, and install it, as well as the software drivers. So this is how the Epson 570 is shipped. You can see it comes on a smaller sized wooden pallet, but it is palletized in this large box. It is not terribly heavy. You can get it off the truck with two able-bodied people, so it's not too difficult to carry. If you only do have one person, you may want to request a lift gate on the truck, but it is relatively light. So what we'll do is we'll go ahead and remove the packing material and start unboxing the printer. So we've gone ahead and cut the straps, removed the plastic wrapping material, and then scored the top to open up the top to see the contents. One thing we do want to remind you of, we always cut the UPC stickers off the boxes. You never know when Epson may offer a promotion or anything like that where that UPC code could come in handy. So we just take a blade and cut that right off. So that's a good thing to keep in mind. So what we'll do is we'll go ahead and open this guy up and show you what's inside. So we'll go ahead and open up the box, show you what's inside. Basically, we've got the output tray. We've got boxes of inks. We also have another set of initial inks as well. So we have two sets of ink. We have two rolls of 17-inch multi-use transfer paper. Obviously the printer, the spindle is in the printer, and then your power cord and your user manuals. So we'll go ahead and just start unboxing and taking all of this stuff out. So here's the entire contents of the box. Hidden was a maintenance tank. This is in the styrofoam side packing in the box. We also have a 24-inch roll of multi-use paper and a installation guide. So you can use that in conjunction with this video to help you set it up, and the inks and the output tray, as we mentioned earlier. Also want to mention that there is an optional stand available. We're not showing that here today, but you can get a stand with a catch basket as well as an option. So now we're going to go ahead and start removing the tape. We're going to start over here on the left side in this left cover. Go ahead and remove that and then open up the door. And then we're going to remove this piece as well. So this is just locking down the cutter mechanism. So we'll get that out and then we'll continue on removing the rest of the tape. Next we'll come over here, open up the cover. And then inside we've got this little orange piece. We'll go ahead and turn that counterclockwise and remove that as well. So you guys will be able to see all of the tape and the protective plastic material that remains, and we're just going to continue removing all of that. So we've spun the printer around, and what you're looking at is the back, and in specific the ports or the connections. Over here is our power port, so we're going to plug the power cable in there. This is a hardwired Ethernet port for networking. This port right here is your USB 3.0 port, so you can connect your computer via USB or Ethernet. This port actually is not used. It's an optional USB port, but it's not used on this printer. You can also connect via Wi-Fi, though we do not recommend that. We actually prefer the hardwired Ethernet connection or the USB connection. Also on the back side, towards the left back, is the access bay for the maintenance tank. So to get to that, we're just going to swing that down and then pull the maintenance tank out. Now, the maintenance tank basically is where unused ink goes. So when it initially charges it, as well as anytime you do a head cleaning, that's where the extra ink goes, and you'll be replacing that periodically. The printer will tell you when to do it. So we're now ready to put the ink in the printer. We have not powered it up yet, so we're not turning it on. Here are the starter bottles. What we want to do with this ink is shake it before we put it in. Now, for our friends up north in cold environments, we do want to let this ink come to room temperature. You do not want to put this stuff in right as it comes in if it's really cold, so let it come to room temperature first. So what we'll do is, with any time we're putting new ink in or ink that's been sitting, we're just going to go ahead and just shake it for about 5 seconds. So you can grab them all here this initial time and just give it a shake. And then we're going to go ahead and open up the cover and put the ink in. So we're going to go ahead and put the ink in. Each one of these bottles is 140 milliliters, by the way, so we'll just go ahead and unscrew that top and remove it. We're not squeezing it or anything like that. You'll notice up here there's these little notches, and these actual inks are keyed for each bay or each color. So when we open up the ink cover, you can see they're obviously color-coded. And what we're going to do is we're going to lift up, all right, that cover, and then we're going to go ahead and insert the ink and then just let it drain. So basically, we're not squeezing it, we're not trying to force it or anything like that. We just insert it and then let it drain. So if you actually look at the front, you can see that it's now filling up. Each one of these cartridges has lines on that to kind of indicate where the level is. You've got the bottom line, which is obviously low, and then the top line. So once it reaches that top line, I'm going to go ahead and remove that ink. Now, there will be a little bit of ink left over in the bottle that I can use at a later time. So that's why we don't want to throw away that cap that we just removed over there. One of the other important things, and you'll learn this when in operation reading the manual, is you do not want to let this ink get below this bottom line for too long. All right, you don't want this thing draining out because it can damage the printer. So just make sure that you kind of visually keep an eye on these ink levels as you're operating it in the future. So you can see we're almost to the top. I'm not sure if you can see those indicator lines there, but we're almost at the top line. So what we're going to do is go ahead and remove the black, no drippage, and then just put the cap right back on. So now we're going to go ahead and just repeat that for all the subsequent colors. Go ahead and just close that cap and then move on to magenta, yellow, and cyan. So we just finished with the last ink bottle, put the caps on, put them aside because we're going to actually grab those in a second and refill. So we'll close the cover at this point. We went ahead and plugged the power cable in, and we're going to go ahead and power up the printer. So we're going to go ahead and power it up. One of the nice little features is we can tilt up the LCD control panel. The power button's right here in the lower left-hand corner, so we're going to go ahead and press that, press and hold it, and it will turn on. So there's a few things we need to do here on the first setup. We're going to select a language. You're welcome. And then it's basically going to say see setup guide and remove all the protector. We already did all of that. So once we've done it, we're going to go ahead and hit the done. We'll enter the month, date and year. So, and that's actually right. So we'll hit okay. Choose our hour format. We're good. And basically we're now at the preparing screen. And the printer is going through the motions here and realizing that this is the first time it's been turned on. All right, so ultimately after about 25 seconds, it's going to come to the information screen and just kind of give us a warning about, you know, how to fill the ink and what to do, what not to do. So we're just going to go ahead and hit proceed. It's warning us, make sure all the colors are filled up to the upper line on the tank, which we did earlier, and then hit start. So basically this initializing is going to happen on the very first time, really the very first time only. It's charging and priming the printer with this initial ink. So it's getting it in the plumbing, getting it in the print heads, and this does take some time. So anywhere between about 25 and 30 minutes, this will be ready. So at this point, we really can just kind of walk away But one thing you don't want to do is turn the printer off during this process, because it will have to restart the entire process if it loses power or gets turned off during this initial priming period. So the initial ink charge is finished now, and one interesting thing was when we first started it, the front panel told us it was going to take about 75 minutes to complete, and it was nowhere near 75 minutes, it was about 30 minutes. So don't freak out when you see that 75 minute thing, it's about 30 minutes. It does consume some of the ink because some of that ink had to go into the plumbing. So at this point, what we're going to go ahead and do is just take the rest of the ink in those bottles and go ahead and fill up the rest of those tanks. So once you open up the ink tank cover to start refilling the inks, this message comes up on the front panel and kind of is walking you through, giving you some warnings about not letting the ink get too low, but it also kind of gives a misleading message about not being more than two-thirds full. I'm not sure why that says that. Maybe there's extra cartridge or tank area we can't see, but we definitely want to fill it up to the top line if we have enough ink to do that. Okay, so we can definitely go to the top line. So just to kind of step you through this now, once we have filled up the ink tanks with the rest of our ink, we've got some messages here. So we want to, it's telling us, hey, fill it up to the top line if you can. All right, so we're going to proceed. Well, we didn't. All right, so it's saying select the colors that you did refill. So we're going to go ahead and select all of them because we did refill or put ink in all of them. All right. And is it asking, is it up to the top line? Well, no, it didn't make it up to the top line with the remaining ink that we had in the bottle. So we're going to say no. So then it's saying set the ink level matching with the following area. So what's cool is I can sit there and actually put this up and down. All right. So we can hit proceed and we're going to go ahead and set the level on black. And we're about 3/4 on black. All right, and then we're going to hit OK, and then we're going to select our magenta. We're a little bit higher on magenta, and then yellow, and then finally cyan. All right, so now it's been set. The reason we walk through that is because the printer is actually tracking the remaining ink based on what we just set in that previous menu. So by doing that, it can give us warnings on where that ink level is. If I had left it where it was, it would have given us a warning way prematurely before the ink was actually bottoming out. So basically, once you refill that ink, you tell it where the ink level is, and then the printer will track the ink accurately. So at this point, really the printer is ready to print. You would load the software and start printing, but before we do that, we like to first, verify that it's printing okay, and second, make sure it's printing at a very high quality. So the first thing we're going to do is go ahead and load a sheet of paper, a single sheet of paper, so that we can do a nozzle check to make sure that all the nozzles are firing. So to do that, we're going to go to the front panel. If we're not in the home menu, we'll just hit the home button, but we were already there. Then we're going to go to paper setting, and we're going to select between roll paper, auto sheet feeder, or cut sheet, one sheet. So since we're just doing a nozzle check, I'm just going to do it on a piece of plain, inexpensive paper. So I'm going to go to cut sheet one. So when I click that, it's basically telling me what to do on the screen. So it's guiding me through the process. So I'm going to go ahead and just open up this cover. All right. So here, this is actually a little misleading. We're not going to use this. This is the auto sheet feeder, and this is where you would stack several sheets at a time. If we're doing one single sheet, we're going to push this forward, and we're basically going to drop that single sheet right here. There's a little paper icon kind of showing you where that right edge should go with a ledge. So I'm going to go ahead and grab a single sheet of plain copy paper, line it up on that edge, and then drop it into the printer. And then you'll feel a little bit of resistance. And then you're gonna hear a beep. When you hear that beep, the sensor has seen it and the printer can grab it. Now, if we come back over to the front panel, it's asking, hey, what kind of paper is this? So I'm gonna go ahead and select paper.
And if we go through the list, you'll see other a list of papers. At this point, we don't really care too much about what type of paper because we're just doing a nozzle check, okay? So we're gonna go ahead and just select the generic paper size. We're gonna go ahead and change that to letter size, so 8.5 by 11. We'll go to the US, oops, wrong menu. We'll go to US, and then 8.5 by 11, and then we're gonna say okay. So at this point, the printer is grabbing the paper, all right, and then it's gonna check to make sure it's straight, and then we'll take us back to the ready menu. All right, so it grabbed it. So now we're gonna go ahead and run a nozzle check. So we'll come back to the settings menu. All right, we're gonna hit the settings. We're gonna go to maintenance, and then we're gonna hit print head nozzle check. So when I click that, we're gonna hit start because we already have the right paper source selected. So it's gonna go ahead and print that nozzle check pattern. So the printer prints out the nozzle check pattern, takes about 10 seconds. We'll go ahead and grab that and take a look. So here we can basically see we've got some stair steps and we've got two columns per color. So cyan, magenta, yellow, and black, or cyan, yellow, magenta, black. So what we're looking for is basically any gaps or missing lines, like about an eighth inch. Each one of these little eighth inch stair steps is a nozzle. So if we see any missing lines, that means we have nozzle clogs. Well, on this one, first shot, we're perfect. So no issues with this nozzle check. That means we can print without banding or lines and get the high quality. On the front panel, it's asking us, hey, are there any issues? So if there are issues, I'd hit the X button and it would take me to a cleaning menu where I could push a button and the printer would self-clean those nozzles. Otherwise, if we're good, we're gonna hit the O, all is good, and we can basically hit the home button and take it back to the main menu. So now that we've done the nozzle check, the next thing we're gonna do is a print quality adjustment. And we're gonna go ahead and choose to do that on the roll media that came with the printer. So to load roll media, we're gonna go ahead and open up this back cover. And then to access the spindle, there's a blue lever here. We're just gonna push that up and that's gonna allow us to grab the spindle and pull it out. So when we pull the spindle out, the black side's actually on the right side and the clear side's on the left side. And the reason we denote between that is this one's adjustable, comes off. So 17 inch, 24 inch. This one's fixed, we're not moving it. Marks the right edge or the starting edge to the printer. So we'll go ahead and remove this. Here's our 24 inch roll of paper that came with the printer. And we're gonna go ahead and put this on the spindle and we're putting it with the paper wrapping around clockwise as we're looking down on the paper. So we want it basically coming over the top going into the printer. So once we put that on, we'll go ahead and put the clear piece on and make sure it's nice and snug. One thing to note, those of you who print with other Epson 24 inch printers, this printer only supports 2-inch roll media, not 3-inch, okay? So don't buy the other 3-inch die sub paper to work in this machine. So now we're ready to go ahead and put it back, drop it back into the printer. And on the front panel, when we opened up, it sensed that we were loading roll paper. So we're gonna just step through, all right? And then feed the paper down into the printer. And there's a slot that I'm feeding this into. I'm gonna just keep feeding it. And then the printer's gonna beep. I'm gonna go ahead and close the top and select my paper type. And we'll just go for rigid. We're gonna do some Chromalux. And we'll say okay. And the printer will load that roll media into the printer. All right, so now that the roll media has been loaded, it takes us back to this screen. What we wanted to do is a print quality adjustment. So we're gonna go into settings, maintenance, print quality adjustment, and then basically we're going to hit start because we have the roll paper selected. So what this is gonna do is it's gonna print out a pattern and a series of patterns. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna visually look at this and plug in some numbers. And this will make a lot more sense once we see that pattern printed.
So it's not auto?
So the printer prints the alignment pattern and then cuts it. So what we're looking at here is four separate patterns, and we're going to enter data into the printer for those four patterns. So what we're looking at here in the top row is basically what we're going to do is we're going to choose the one that looks the cleanest. And you can see obviously minus 12 is terrible, plus 12 is terrible, all right? As you move in, it's getting cleaner and cleaner and cleaner. You don't see these horizontal lines and banding. And in this case, zero is the winner. All right, so then we're gonna look at number two, and we're gonna evaluate this row. Again, it looks like zero is the cleanest one. Now, on number three and number four, we got a different alignment. So you may or may not be able to see this, but we basically have a top line and a bottom line, all right? One is offset to the right, one is offset to the left. What we're looking for is the one that doesn't have any offset. All right, so this we want to pick either minus 6, minus 4, minus 2, 0, 2, 4, or 6. We want to pick the one that's straight up and down, not offset, okay? So as I look at this, I can see these are really, really offset. The bottom is pushing over to the left. Over here, the bottom is pushing over to the right. And once again, it looks like 0 is the best pattern, all right? So then I'm going to go down to number 4, and I'm going to look at just this row. And again, offset, 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 and then 0 is the best number, all right? You may need a loop for this. Some people will be able to do it with their naked eye. You may need a loop, but what we're doing is we're picking the best set of numbers. Now, in this particular case, 0 is actually the default, so this printer right out of the box was very, very well aligned. So now, what we're gonna do is we're gonna go ahead and go over to the front panel, and since we circled those, now we can come over here and enter those values. So if I were to change, or if I needed to change it, I would just hit the plus or the minus. Well, number one, the best value is 0, so we're gonna hit alignment number 2. Same thing for alignment number 2, I don't need to change it, the best one was 0. Same thing for number 3, and same thing for number 4. And that's it. All right, so now what we're gonna do is go ahead and print the second page. All right, so the second page is printed. Similar concept, looks a little different. So we're picking the cleanest one without lines or banding. All right, so first row is 0. And it looks like actually on number 2, this particular row, minus 1 is the best. Down here, we're looking at this vertical column, and it looks like 0 is the best here. So now we're gonna go back to the front panel and then go ahead and enter those numbers. So, coming back to the front panel, and this screen is automatically put up. We don't have to do anything to get to this screen. So number 1 was 0, so we're going to hit next. Number 2 is actually minus 1, so we'll plug in minus 1. And number 3 is 0, so we'll hit OK. All right, so now we have completed the print head alignment, or the print quality setting. All right, so we wanted to talk about the output stacker. If you are going to be printed to a stack of sheets, again, remember, we're going to use the sheet stacker right here. Stack our sheets in. This will actually collect them so the sheets don't spit out onto the ground. So if you look at this, basically this has got two little fingers here, and then there's two slots underneath the printer that this is going to fit into. So we'll just basically slide that in like that. And now when you print a stacked set of sheets, they will come out and stack on the stacker. So that's pretty much all the hands-on with getting the printer set up. Now at this point, we're going to go ahead and install the drivers on the Mac and Windows platforms. The printer does not come with software in the box, so what we're going to do is we're actually going to download those from the website. We can access those through dtgweb.com on our support, our product support page, or you can go to Epson.com and download them there as well. Epson no longer includes drivers in the box for their printers for a variety of reasons, but you can download them from the internet. At dtgweb.com, we can actually access those drivers for each printer product just right on the product page. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to click in the search box, type F570, hit return, go ahead and click on the product page, And then for each product, we have a support tab. So I'll click on that support tab, and we've got a variety of links to documentations, videos, things like that. So here, I'll click on the 570 drivers link. That'll take me to Epson.com, which has all of the latest drivers and firmware for each product. So in this case, we're on a Windows system. It has detected my operating system. So what we'll do is we'll go ahead and click on drivers. And then we've got two choices here, the printer driver as well as the drivers and utilities package, which includes a variety of packages associated with the printer. So we'll go ahead and download that by clicking the download link and then clicking save in our browser. Once the file is finished downloading in your web browser, we'll go ahead and go to our downloads folder in Windows Explorer, click on downloads. And then this is the file for the combination package that we just downloaded right here. So I'm going to go ahead and double click that and just say yes to all the Windows stuff and OK. And what this is doing is extracting the installer for the main installer page. So once we're finished through here, it will ask us to make a few selections. First, we'll select English as our language, then we'll accept the terms, and then we're going to go ahead and install all of these links, and you'll see the EpsonNet utility come in handy in a few seconds. So we'll go ahead and click install, and what this is doing is it's actually going out to Epson.com and downloading the rest of the support files. So obviously you do need an internet connection throughout this process. It's launching and installing the Epson NetConfig utility. All right, so then we're just going to click Next. And then it's asking us to confirm that the ink has been charged, and we went through that already. So we're going to click Next. The next thing is it's asking us to select our connection. So this utility will automatically install the driver based on printers it sees connected to your network or your computer directly. First is the wireless connection. We actually don't really recommend wireless. You can do it, absolutely, but wireless can tend to kind of be inconsistent in terms of speed, and it's not really a good thing for that printer to slow down or wait for data when it's printing. Again, you can do it, but not really recommended. You can also connect directly via USB. One of the warnings here is do not connect the printer until it prompts you. So if you select this and click Next, it's going to prompt you when to connect the printer. And then finally, we're going to go wired network connection. That's the methodology we're using via Ethernet. So I'm going to go ahead and click that. And then when I hit Next, it's basically going to ask me, is it set up for the first time, or are we setting it up for the first time, or is the printer already on my network? Well, the printer's already on my network. And when I click that, it actually goes out and searches. Now, in this particular case, I'm kind of glad it happened because it's a real-world case, is this version of Windows I'm showing you this connection on or setup on is actually in a version of Parallels on a Mac Mini. So it's actually having an issue finding the printer because of my proxy IP address. So it can't find it. So when I click OK, I'll just keep clicking these and hit Next. It will never find it, and I'll get in this loop, and I'll never be able to set up the printer. So a way around this, if this ever happens to you, is to download the printer driver only, not the utility combo package to install the printer driver, but just the printer driver. So I went ahead and did that. So I'm going to cancel out of this install. If everything had gone smoothly, by the way, it would see the printer. I would select the printer, hit Next, and just finish through the installation, and the printer would be ready to use. But in this case, we're going to go ahead and click Yes to cancel out and exit, and we're going to download the printer driver. All right, so when I click on that and download it, we're basically going to go to our downloads folder, oops, and then here is the printer driver itself. So I'll go ahead and double click on that, click yes. All right, and it's asking me is this the printer you want to install? Yes, of course. Click OK, language, OK, and then agree to the terms. All right, so in this case, what I'm going to do is instead of a network connection, I'm going to click USB connection. I'm going to lie to it. I'm going to click OK. And basically, it can't find it. So instead of, you know, going back and trying to redo it, I'm going to click manual. I'm going to click on that. And with manual, I can basically just kind of lie to it, pick one of these ports, say okay, and it will go ahead and continue to install the driver, thinking it's an on that USB port. So you can see here, it says printer driver installation and port configuration were completed successfully. So we got through the driver install. All right. So what I can do is I can launch that utility that I had earlier, the Epson Net Config utility. All right. We'll launch that. And this utility goes out and finds Epson printers on my network. So it's searching, and sure enough, there it is. Now I can see what IP address my network gave the printer. So it's this 192.168.0.101. Now when I go into my printers, all right, so it installed the driver, right? So if I go to my printers in Windows, I can find my Epson 500 series, and I can manage that. Then I can go to printer properties, ports, add a port. It's a standard TCP/IP port. Click next. And now all I have to do is type in the address of where that printer is found. So we'll type in that address. Oops. Then click next. And it found it and it's finished. So that was, you know, that second method where I downloaded the printer driver was kind of a convoluted way of adding that printer. But we do take support calls where the printer is not automatically found all the time. So that's a manual way to get around it. Otherwise, if you just typical use, if you're connected via USB or a standard network, just nexting through that standard driver install, the combo package, will get you all the way there as well. Now we'll go ahead and show you the Mac install. So as mentioned before, you can access all drivers and help on dtgweb.com. So we'll search for F570 in the search box. Click on the product page of the F570 printer and then click the support link, which shows us links for manuals, utilities, etc. So we'll go ahead and click on the drivers link. That will take us to Epson.com, which will have all of the latest drivers and firmware for their printer. And it did automatically detect my operating system, so I'll just click on drivers, and we'll download this package right here, the drivers and utilities combo package, which is the printer driver, as well as some other applications associated with the F570. All right, so once it downloads, I'll go to my downloads folder, all right, and basically double click and open the installer file for the F570. So that will open up the actual installer app. We'll double click on that and it will launch the installer. All right, so basically answer the questions that it's asking, agree to the terms. All right, and we're going to go ahead and install all of these applications, including the Epson Net Configuration utility, which is a really handy utility for showing and configuring network settings for Epson printers. So we'll click on install, and it's going to go ahead and download those accessory files from Epson.com. All right, it's going to ask for your password if you have those kinds of security settings set up on your Mac. So we'll go ahead and enter that. And it's installing the drivers and utilities. All right, so once it finishes installing all the files, we'll go ahead and click start to begin the printer setup. All right, so it's asking us here, have you charged the ink? Have you installed the ink in the printer? And yes, we did do that. So we'll check that box, click continue. Now here it's showing you your connection method. How are you going to print to the printer? How are you going to connect to it? We've got wireless connection, which we don't necessarily recommend. You can certainly do it, but wireless connections to printers especially tend to be non-consistent in speed. So you don't really want that printer kind of waiting on data and stopping and pausing in the print. And that can happen with wireless connections. So you can certainly use it, but not recommended by DTG. You can also connect via directly via USB to your computer. What it is warning you is don't connect the printer, all right, until it prompts you. All right, so if you select this, then click continue, it will actually tell you when to connect that USB cable to the printer and the computer. All right, and then finally, wired network connection, that's our preferred method, which is just an Ethernet connection installed on our network. So we're basically connecting to the printer through network. So I'm going to go ahead and select wired network connection. Click continue. The printer is already on our network. So if I click that, we'll actually go out and automatically search our network. And sure enough, it was found. So we're going to go ahead and click the continue button and then click add printer. So basically this is going to add the printer to our our Mac computer. All right, so I'm verifying that it's using the Epson SC500 series driver. So I'll click add. All right, and it's going in adding that printer to our computer. So then we'll just click continue. And we're pretty much finished at this point. It's just going to ask us to register this. We don't have to. I'm just going to close that out and then close this because we're finished installing the Epson F570 drivers on a Mac. Pretty simple.
So that was our unboxing, setup, and installation video of the Epson F570 dye sublimation printer. At DTG, we sell a variety of printers in different sizes. We sell the 6370 from Epson, the 9470, the 64-inch, as well as a variety of heat presses, all the way from 8.5x11 up to 55x110-inch presses, including calendar presses for fabric as well. So one thing we did want to mention about the press, a great, great accessory in terms of heat presses for the F570 is the DK32AP from GeoKnight. 26x32-inch press can do a nice 24x30-inch panel on Chromalux. We appreciate you viewing our video. If you have any questions at all, please give us a call at 800-681-0024 or visit dtgweb.com. Also look for some additional color profiles for the F570. We will be building a variety of custom profiles for fabrics, shirts, Chromalux, ceramics. We will be posting those on our web and sharing those with our customers. Thanks again.